So this week is bio-inspired engineering week. And so we have honor and great pleasure to have two distinguished guests visiting us this week. And they will be totally full seminars. And Professor Tang Daniel will give two IAS distinguished lectures. One is today, and the next one will be on Friday, 10:30, also at this lecture venue, and followed by Professor Sanjay Sen from National Center for Biological Science, NCBS, in India, and he will be delivering two lectures, one on Friday afternoon, the other will be on Monday. So, well, Tang is no stranger to HKUST. He's a senior visiting fellow at IAS, and also one of the International Advisory Committee members at BME divisions. So Tang has a very unique background. He got his academic training from zoology, biology. Then he got his PhD in biology, but then he received his engineering training in Caltech. He spent several years. He used to do a lot of computational fluid mechanics, to my knowledge. They share similar research expertise that our provost, Professor Wei Shi. And he was actually the founding chair in the Department of Biology in UW Seattle. And Tang is a very innovative person, and he has received a lot of awards, including MacArthur's Junior's Grant. And many of you know that MacArthur's Junior Fellowship is very difficult to get, only award to those who are doing extremely innovative research. And he's also recipient of Guggenheim Fellowships, right? And because of that fellowship, so we don't need to pay for his air flight ticket to come to come here. So he's very cheap to be here. So, well, anyway, he has been serving in many of the editorial advisory committees, including Science Magazine and many others. So without further ado, please join me to welcome Professor Tang Daniel.
Wonderful. Thank you, Yiming, for the cheap introduction. I'm going to pay you back for that. It's a thrill being here, and Yiming asked me to come and give a series of talks at this interface of life sciences and engineering with an idea to look at how these two domains can actually benefit each other. And I'm going to focus today on something that's been an ongoing project with me, and actually Yiming has been part of this. It started with work advising with DARPA on the future of computing. And there's a particular panel called the Information Science and Technology Advisory Panel for DARPA, who's charged with asking what are the big, hairy, open problems in computing, what might the future hold. I am not a computer scientist. I'm much more of a neuroscientist. But I think I wanted to begin with this sort of provocative title and to see how far we can go down this path here. The title is Bio-Inspired Low-Energy Information Processing in the End of Moore's Law. And it's actually not that biology is driving the end of Moore's Law, but there's an interesting confluence going on at this time in our history. Before I delve into this, I always like to get my acknowledgments out front so that in case you fall asleep, you get the most important parts here. It's right, yeah. So he's good with computer, but he's not good with the mouse. You'll see why I have that there in that particular order, actually, that means something in a minute. So I want to thank you for the invitation and for IAS. It's been really rewarding for me to come here and interact with amazing faculty and students, and I'd like to continue this and certainly have people come to the University of Washington. Most importantly, I need to acknowledge my very happy and gleeful laboratory of students, all of whom have played various roles in the research that I'm going to talk about today as well as on Friday. And I've talked about a number of projects over the years. Today, I think I'm going to focus a little on Itai Roth, Annika Eberle, Brad Dickerson, Brian Hinson. Melanie is an electrical engineering undergraduate, as is Kit Gathinji. And Brandon and Darren and Robert are all neuroscience students. So some of their work is going to be referenced throughout today's talk. And I, of course, have to acknowledge our funding sources, National Science Foundation, Air Force Research Laboratory, the Air Force Office of Scientific Research, and the University of Washington Institute of Neuroengineering. And somewhere in there is the Guggenheim that lets me come here cheaply. Great. Yeah, no uniform. That's great. So there is Yiming and the mouse. And I put some numbers up here. This is generous. Most humans have about 80 billion neurons in their brain. I gave Yiming a few extra billion just for today. So he's approximately 100 times 10 to the ninth neurons. And with that, he's able to accomplish amazingly challenging tasks. He can give introductions, for better or for worse. He can walk, he can talk, he can do all sorts of activities. And he does amazing computations that we actually are unable to do in hardware today. He can do image recognition, voice recognition instantly. He can separate faces in a crowd instantly, as can all of you. Some of you actually, younger individuals have more neurons than older individuals, so all of you are actually smarter than all of us. This is an important thing to know. Three orders of magnitude fewer neurons is a mouse, still fully capable of tasks that no system can do today, right? They can recognize mates, navigate complex environments, operate in sensory-deprived environments, do acoustic localization, odor localization, all kinds of extremely difficult autonomous tasks that we can't get robots to do today. They can manipulate objects with tiny hands, and they do so with a brain not much bigger than a few millimeters in diameter. The fly, similarly, amazing tasks. Now we're getting down to a brain the size of a sesame seed, something with about 100,000 neurons in it. Drosophila has maybe 80,000 neurons. And again, the behavioral repertoire is beyond anything we can build. And at this point, they're getting so small, we can't even build machines this size, let alone machines that are autonomous and mobile at this dimension. The nematode, Caenorhabditis elegans, has exactly 302 neurons. It has, again, with just 302 neurons, more behavior than we can compute, than we can understand by simple modeling of their neural systems. So it's already, even at 302 neurons, this is exceeding our capabilities for predictive modeling on the rich behavior that they do. We can do elements of it. But one of the key investigators on Caenorhabditis elegans, C. elegans, Corey Barkman, said, after this many decades of studying these animals, we know every neuron. They've all been identified. All of their connections are known, and many of their properties are known. And we still can't do our computes, can't understand the computes that they do fully. She says, we only have ourselves to blame. This is a hard problem. Some have zero neurons, right? This paramecium is a single-celled organism, and it is fully capable of autonomous life. It detects things, it senses things, it makes decisions on the basis of information that it receives chemically and mechanically, not particularly optically. And at the end of the day, this device here is a protein. And at the end of the day, a protein can undergo a conformational change in response to either a voltage gradient across it, such as a voltage-gated channel, or it can undergo a conformational change in response to a ligand binding to it. And at the end of the day, it undergoes a state change in response to a signal. That is a computation. Some proteins can take two signals, and only in the presence of two do they respond. They're basically doing an AND operation. At the scale of, I made this number up. It's not 10 to the minus 8 neurons. I mean, it's just a part of a neuron is involved in computation. Okay. So again, these numbers are approximate. I just wanted to give you thousandfold orders of magnitude. So the question we generally are asking in this area of bio-inspired engineering is, what do engineered systems do better than natural systems? It's really important to identify those features. And what is it that natural systems do better than engineered systems? And at the end of the day, are there things that we can do by using the two together that do better than either one alone? That's a really interesting problem. So let me now talk a little about engineered systems. And I use that title, End of Moore's Law, as being a bit of a provocative title here. But the End of Moore's Law suggests that the prediction that we were, sorry, I gotta go back, that we were making, that Moore made, it's not a law, it's a trend, in about 1965, suggested that the number of transistors per device is going to double every 18 months. And what was happening in this time is transistors are getting ever smaller and fabrication is getting ever better. Transistors at this point and around 2012 are beginning to level off. That is, you're hitting a lower bound to the size of transistors. And that lower bound is somewhere around 14 nanometers, maybe 10 nanometers, if you want to be generous. And people at Intel say, you know, this is pretty much a lower bound based on electron tunneling that's going to happen, right? It's simply unavoidable beneath a certain size. And this is separate from all the fabrication. I will remind you, proteins are only a few nanometers in diameter. Some are as small as 2, some are as large as 10. But proteins obviously are not transistors. Or are they? Yeah, we'll poke at that at the end of the talk. Clock rate has also leveled off. It's just so fast you can cycle these systems. And that clock rate leveled off somewhere close to 10,000 megahertz, not quite, right? Somewhere above 1,000 megahertz, right? So clock rate has leveled off. Number of transistors per VLSI is leveling off. And in fact, transistor size is reaching some serious limits at about 10 or so nanometers. So this is one of the suggestions from DARPA that what's the future of computing? What's going on? A colleague of mine, Luis Seze, who is now working partly at Microsoft, is also interested in storage. It's called the storage gap. That is, the amount of information being generated is rising exponentially relative to the kinds of storage systems that we're producing today. He is particularly interested, and I won't talk about this today, in using DNA as a storage mechanism. And in fact, in a per unit weight basis, DNA can outstore anything we've ever made, except the read and write time are weeks. So depending on how patient you are with your I.O., DNA may not be the most optimal storage thing. That said, the technology for reading and writing DNA is never going to go away. It's not going to be, because we're always going to be looking at DNA, just because that's a good part of our lives. So it's an interesting issue that DNA is a fascinating storage mechanism. It lasts a long time. We can still get DNA from mammoths. So that's an interesting, long-lived, efficient, per unit mass storage. It's terrible at the read and write, but that's maybe a big challenge for the future. And the graph that sort of motivated today's talk is the trends in efficiency of computing. So even though computing is getting faster and faster and faster, but the clock rate is somewhat leveled off, and the number of transistors is increasing, right? So too is the efficiency. And this is instructions per microjoule. Okay, so how many ands per microjoule, or XORs, or whatever you might do. Versus year, and this is a Dell Latitude. So again, this is not a measure of speed, nor is it a measure of precision. It is a measure of what does it cost each of these different units to do an instruction, right? And the author of this study, Kumi, along with Josh Smith at the University of Washington, estimated instructions in the human brain, and they came out roughly 4 orders of magnitude more efficient than the best systems we have today. I'm going to have to back that up, because how they estimate instruction is a bit sloppy. How you estimate the energy costs of natural computing is a challenge. So that's what we're going to drill down on, is just to see how natural systems do the compute. How can you measure the efficiency of computing in a living system? I will point out that there is a new call that just came out for a multidisciplinary university research initiative called a MURI, and it happens to have exactly the same title as this talk, Bio-Inspired Low-Energy Information Processing. So they're looking for large teams to kind of nail this problem. Be interesting partnership with our institutions. One of the challenges we're facing is, what is an instruction? How do you do a fair comparison? And Bert works in neuromorphic computing. There are some direct comparisons we could do. We'll look more at this later on. How would you measure the energy in natural computed systems? Okay. And I put this up here. You're going to see this over and over again. There's that paramecium. That's a single cell, right? This is a small adult wasp. Okay, it's a fully functioning animal. This scale bar is 300 micrometers. This is not a big insect. It has a brain. It has eyes. We have no idea how many neurons it has. This is about the smallest flying insect we know of. They're essentially plankton in the air. They have a brain. And what we do know is that the smaller the neuron is, the more efficient the system is. So efficiency increases as neuron size increases. This is probably the most efficient computing on the planet. I don't actually know how many neurons there are in this. I can estimate a lower bound by just counting the number of eye fascicles. There have to be at least as many as there are eye fascicles. At least that many. And that's already 1,000. So it's kind of fun. Do not pick this as a research project, because doing electrophysiology, that's things that are smaller than your electrodes, is not a good idea. And I just added this one because I just find this interesting, speaking of eyes. This is sensor size. And what you have here is the number of pixels per unit area, essentially, to these 40 megapixel cameras, the highest density, or reasonably high density, is this Pentax at about 50,000 sensors per millimeter squared. That's just stunning, stunning level of density of sensors until you look at biology. The human eye in the focal plane is about 100,000 per square millimeter. That's pretty impressive. The eye of the hawk, Buteo, is the genus, B-U-T-E-O. That eye can see a mouse from aloft. And that eye has about a million per square millimeter. And again, this is not the whole eye, but in specific areas, there's density, an increasingly high density. And just for fun, I did an estimate of the optical density of this little thing here. It's a very, very crude eye. If you look, those are what are called omatidias, the separate fascicles of the insect's eye. If you know this linear dimension and you know how many there are, and the whole thing is only 300 micrometers long, the whole animal is only 300 micrometers long, you can estimate that these teeny eyes are getting about 500,000 per millimeter squared, something like that. And again, these are rough estimates. Give or take an order of magnitude, I'm still pretty impressed, right? And by the way, their brain has neurons like ours does. Their brain computes with action potentials like ours does. Unlike our brains, they're so tiny, there's no room for a nucleus. So in the formation of the brain, the neurons divided but left the nuclei in the mother cell, because there's just simply no room for a nucleus in the brain of these animals. The brain is so precious that it doesn't just fill the space between the eyes. It actually extends down into the flight muscles. So when they fly, they're squeezing their brain. It's not something I would recommend. The brain is total brain size is approximately the size of 3 to 4 red blood cells. So the neurons, however many there are approaching some size limits that might be just like the transistor problem. They're getting so tiny that channel noise, the protein channels, which are governing neuronal signaling, may be limiting at this point. Again, really don't know much about this. And I'm afraid I'm going to leave them. Visual sensory systems, we're very visual creatures. We tend to think about that. I would be remiss if I didn't point out some other extrema in sensing and processing in nature. This male moth here detects the presence of female pheromones through chemoreceptors in the antenna. And the chemoreceptors have a protein amplification system so that when the female pheromone binds to that protein protein system, it's a G protein cascade, it amplifies that signal. To the extent that a single molecule of female pheromone is sufficient to drive behavior, okay? And the estimates now is somewhere around 1 in 10 to the 17th. That's about the concentration. There isn't a chemosensor we have ever fabricated as synthetically that matches that. What I will talk about on the Friday lecture, and I'll just spoiler alert, is this is so good and so light, right, that why should I even bother fabricating a chemosensor when I can just take it from the animal? And we've actually started a project where we're placing the isolated antenna and the neurons in them onto quad rotors for chemosensing. Long story, it's called a smellicopter, but it's kind of fun. And again, mechanosensing is something I care a lot about, and spiders. And I just saw an amazing spider on your property here. It was about that body. It's a banana spider. How many have seen that here? It's about that long, leg spread about like that. Yeah. And what the spiders do is they feel vibrations, and they have to be exquisitely sensitive to vibrations. And it turns out Friedrich Bart, using laser scanning methods and laser imaging, had calculated there's a sensory structure in the joints of the leg. This is one of the joints here. And that sensory structure has 10 nanometer resolution. A 10 nanometer deflection is sufficient to drive a neuron responding. 10 nanometers. And then you get a large neuronal response. The cost of that sensing is tiny. We can't make devices that have that level of sensitivity that cheaply. Okay? We can make atomic force microscopes, AFMs, but they're not running inside the leg of a spider. So again, I'm not saying that nature does the best computing and the best of everything on the planet. But what it does very well. But it doesn't do precise computing. It doesn't do rapid computing. There isn't a human in this room, with the possible exception of Professor Xing, who can do e times pi in 12 nanoseconds. Too late. But there isn't a computer in this room that can match how you track a conversation and learn in class and do what you do. Okay, so now let's start diving down. In real neural networks, particularly in the visual system of both insects and vertebrates, ours, the hawk, as well as the fly, right? Information is present in the environment in terms of light, right? And as you go through successive layers through the neural system, you see this sort of graded response eventually transforming from layer to layer to layer in the visual cortex of our system, or in the equivalent in insect system is called the medulla and lamina and lobula in insect systems. In these cortices, you see this increased movement towards a pulsatile kind of logic here, pulsatile information. And these we call these action potentials, and we'll be talking more about this later. How many of you are familiar with what an action potential is? Can I see hands? Okay, this is good for me to know. This is, I apologize for asking this question, but this is a neuronal signal. This is what a single neuron is doing in response to visual temporally varying signals, okay? And I'll talk a little more about that. This is an image from the layers of neuronal systems in a very classic set of illustrations by Ramon y Cajal, an illustrator from the 20s. Is that about right? Do you recall, Bert? Yeah. It's where science and art have a beautiful overlay. He has amazing illustrations of neural systems. Some of them look just beautiful artwork. And he spent a lifetime drawing connections and diagrams of neurons. I strongly recommend you look at his work. So here's what I'm going to do. Now I'm going to give the outline of today's talk. That's my background, okay? What I want to do is say, how do we quantify the efficiency of natural computations? How could we check that estimate of 10 to the fourth greater efficiency in natural systems relative to, say, a Dell Latitude, right? What are the mechanisms that living systems use to promote this efficiency, if it is indeed there? And I'm going to end, if time permits, with future directions in efficient bio-inspired computation. And just some of the areas that we've been working on, partly in workshops with Professor Xing, okay? So here I have some sort of analog-like signal, right? Sort of a continuous signal, continuous time, right? And I could imagine, you know, some sort of detector listening in on these neuronal events that are firing at some relationship to this stimulus, right? And I could digitize these and create a digital signal, which is a discrete time discrete samples, okay? Continuous signals have the advantage that you can represent information with a high rate. It's many bits are sort of present in a single wire, okay? It's a continuous signal, and in fact, if you tried to get the bit resolution, it could be extraordinarily high, okay? The computation is instantiated in the physical arrangement. That is, you know, what is connected to what, you know, which sensor is connected to what amplifier, effectively is the computation, just like in a feedback system, right? So it's an instantiation in the hardware. It is prone to noise accumulation. This is one of the notorious disadvantages of analog signal, just like in us, right? This is not a statement of devices, it's a statement of being analog, right? And it is what we call bespoke computation. That is, the computation is tailor-made for the task at hand. That is, I will build an amplifier with a notch filter because I want the amplifier with a notch filter. I'll build this analog device to do exactly what I want, right? Nothing more and nothing less, typically, right? And it is very, very efficient. It is a very low cost per bit, but it is subject to noise. And noise and signal to noise degrades potentially the information we have available. Discrete signals have the idea that single wires represent single bits. So this is the extremum down here, okay? And noise is shed at each stage of the process, right? So I fire and I come back to my zero state, that means I'm noise free, and then I fire again and I'm back to my zero state, and I always am rejecting noise by definition, right? And that's an incredibly powerful advantage of digital signals, and Boolean primitives make this extremely flexible. I can do ands, XORs, ORs, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? This gives me incredible flexibility with Boolean logic. But it is a fairly high cost per bit. And the reality is neural systems at some point are not quite here, and they're partly here. But they're graded in everything in between. And in this particular thing, we tend to think of this as not quite continuous, not quite analog, but not quite discrete. It's somewhere between discrete noise rejecting events and analog information carrying events. This is called, I made up a word called digilog, digital analog or something. But the other way to think about it is pulsatile. That is, information is sent in pulses, but the pulse geometry and timing carries information. But it is still pulsatile, so noise rejecting. This is a pretty unique feature of natural systems. Okay? Information is encoded in the spike train. That is, when each of these happens, Not much I can do about that one. So just look at this side of the room. But it's entertaining. Most importantly, these require energy. So remember, I launched this discussion by saying that natural systems are computing with 10 to the 4 greater efficiency than silicon, than we can do in CMOS and silicon. Okay. The energy is associated with the following events. This is something called an action potential. And what happens is that neuron is exposed to a signal, and at some point that signal hits a value, and I'm going to talk more about that, that gets that neuron to make that single pulse that says, at this point, I will make a decision to fire the neuron, to elicit the single response. Okay? And to do that, the whole system has to be in a polarized state. It's like a battery, right? And that polarized state is done at the expense of energy, and that energy is in the form of adenosine triphosphate. Okay? And each time one of those pulses happen, the ion separation is slightly and ephemerally reversed. And that over many, many pulses, the energy requirements have to restore that ion separation. Okay? So the ion separation is there so it can depolarize, and it costs energy to separate ions according to their charge and species type. And then on each action potential, each one of these pulses, those ions flow in directions opposite to their polarized state. And in that case, that requires energy in the long term to keep that at the same average level. Okay? So energy is required to support this pulsatile behavior. That's the bottom line. Now our trick is going to be saying, how much energy is that? And in a series of studies done by Simon Laughlin, Jeremy Niven, and others, it was published in Nature Neuroscience quite some time ago, they actually looked at the spiking, at the neuronal activity in the retina of an insect, and measured the energy cost, and measured the ATP requirement for many, many action potentials. And they came up with a number that should be meaningless to you. I'm just going to say, it's 10 to the fifth. Adenosine triphosphate molecules per spike is their estimate average. And I'm going to unbury that later. It shouldn't mean a lot. It's just a number, right? Roughly, it's somewhere between 10 to the fourth and 10 to the sixth. But I just picked the middle of their range, okay? Depending on the type of signal that's being done. Just store that. Okay, so now we have a rough estimate that things are pulsatile in their communication. We know that that's noise rejecting. We know roughly how much it costs to generate these action potentials, these pulses, in terms of adenosine triphosphate. Our next trick is to put two pieces together, is to say, can we estimate the actual information rate, the bit rate associated with neuronal activity, and then can we equate each spike to the bit rate associated with those spikes, and then can we estimate the energy per bit? So that's where I'm going to go, and I'll try and work this out for you. I'm using a system that I'll talk about more again on Friday. The details I don't need to get too much into it right now. What I'm looking at is mechanosensory systems, and these are single neurons that are in they're in all of us. Your hands and legs and everything have mechanosensors. There's neurons with specific channels that open in response to mechanical forces. Okay, so they're transducers. And in the wings of insects, we've been deeply interested in what are they doing with mechanosensory information in their wings. This is a fundamental aerodynamics problem, a fundamental robotics and flight control problem. Okay. But what I can tell you is that the wing and skeleton of these insects are covered in hundreds, somewhere around 500 strain sensors distributed over the surface of this wing, about the same again in the hind wing. They occur in discrete patches, arrays of sensors that are highly regularized, highly structured arrays of sensors. It's an interesting problem. And each single one is a single neuronal ending that ends up in the cuticle or the skeleton of the insect. Okay, and so when the skeleton bends, it stretches that neuron, which opens particular type of channels, which depolarizes that and gets that neuron to fire. Okay. We are interested now in using this as a model to investigate the cost of sensing. And one of the arguments made is, if I'm going to have that many hundreds of sensors and it costs me energy, there should be a reason I'm having them there. Okay? Evolution doesn't just let you have neuronal signaling for free. It's costly. It's expensive, right? And so one of the things we're worried about is, what are they doing with the data? So what we're trying to understand is, if we give controlled information input into the system and measure the information output, we should be able to assess the mutual information between the input and the output, and we should be able to assess how many bits are coming in to those coming out, right? What the mutual information is, which is a direct measure of information processing. We should be able to measure that. So what we do is, we give the system a Gaussian mechanical white noise. It's band limited because you have a physical limit in what you can do to your motors and your wing. So we grab the wing, and I'll just demonstrate this on Professor Xing, and we shake the wing with white noise, okay? I just wanted to shake his hand. And we shake the wing with broadband white noise up to 200 hertz, and more recently up to 300 hertz. And while we're doing that, we place an electrode system into the wing nerve and record from the electrical activity of the neurons in the wing, right? Each individual, we record from many at once, okay? And from that measured output, we get this sort of set of pulses that are produced by those neurons. I have information in, I have information out. The coherence between these is a measure of the mutual information between the input and the output. And that coherence rises and falls off. It falls off because our signal strength falls off. But it gets quite high. And from the coherence, we can use basically an entropy approach to estimate the information contained in the spike train of pulses. And that information is a simple calculation you do over some bandwidth of frequencies. And we did the full bandwidth here. And for a frame of reference, and again, it's not a particularly meaningful number, these single neurons are producing about 150 bits per second in a single neuron, okay? And there are lots of neurons, so you have this beautiful cable. It's better than the modem at my home, used to be. It's not quite Cat 5 Ethernet or whatever you have today, right? An interesting number, probably more interesting in a frame of reference of other sensory systems. The salamander retinal cells, about 3.2 bits per second. The median temporal lobe in the visual cortex monkey brain has been estimated also at about 12 bits per second. Fly visual neurons at 64 bits per second. This keeps going up. Really, in here, you have an electrosensory structure and mechanosensory structures. Those are the highest bit rates that you'll see in biology. And they're all basically operating on a single channel type called a trip channel. I look over to Dr. Chan here, who's studying trip channels as well. Okay, we have a bit rate. Also, I happen to know the cost per spike. What I'd like to know is how many bits per spike I have. So if I know the bit rate and the spike rate, I should be able to calculate the bits per spike. And I have here a table of those. This is our estimate for wing mechanosensors, about 1 to 2 bits per spike, per action, per pulse, at that 150 bits per second. This is a paper from Nature Neuroscience, 99, on a whole variety of estimates of bits per spike. And what you'll notice is, it's not one. Initially, you would say, how can an on or an off represent more than one bit? It's either on or it's off. But there's when it's on and when it's off is critical. And the shape of the action potential also contains information. So it's also possible that each pulse occurs in a way that carries more information than a single bit. I'll just be conservative and use an estimate of 1 bit. So I know I have 1 bit per spike, okay? So even though I said it could carry more than one, I'll just use one. And let's see how far we can go with that. I said it's 10 to the fifth joules, 10 to the fifth ATP molecules per spike. So I know how many ATP molecules I need for a spike, and I know how many bits I have for a spike. I should be able to do this. So the fly visual neurons at about 10 to the fifth ATP per spike, plus or minus an order of magnitude. There's 13 kilocalories per mole of ATP. When you do the calculation, sorry about this, that's 8 femtojoules per bit. It doesn't mean anything. What's the comparison? Comparison would be like a standard laptop or something. So a standard laptop is about 100 watts per gigaflop. And if you know your floating point operations per second, that comes out to be around 3 nanojoules per bit. It's a little better than 3 orders of magnitude more efficient in the natural system. It's not quite as impressive as they estimated for instructions per microjoule, but still pretty good. And honestly, if I can do tenfold better in efficiency, I'm at the year 2080 on my trends graph, okay? So natural systems compute with high efficiency. And the real question now is, what is it about them that gives this extraordinary efficiency? And the first thing to bear in mind is that the compute is done in an analog-ish way, right? So as more analog you are, the more efficient you are, right? But you're still noise rejecting. And the analog compute is basically a protein channel opening up, a protein undergoing a conformational change and allowing a large influx of ions. So for a single conformational change, you get a massive signal locally, okay? A large ion flux in the channel. Okay, I'm going to come back to this. I realize I'm taking too long, so I'll move on fairly quickly. So neurons are firing in response to a stimulus, and in response to that stimulus, they could carry more than a bit of information, okay? What I want to do now is ask, can we look to neural systems to help us in dimension reduction problems, okay? So here's an image from something called the Princeton Face Database. I don't know how many of you are aware of it. It's thousands of faces of humans. And what you can do is you can use methods of a sparse sensing or compressive sensing to ask, how can I optimally separate one face from another? It's called, you know, that sort of sparse sensing problem. I want to be able to do not a compression. I don't want to reconstruct a face. I want to know face A is different from face B. It's a categorical decision and not a compression like a JPEG or something else. It's a categorical decision, right? And what started, actually, is most recently written up by Condes, but in a series of papers by my prior postdoc, Bing Brunton, and her husband, Steve Brunton. They did a series of papers on using sparse and compressive sensing in discrimination tasks. Okay, I'm going to say this is state of the art, roughly, in sparse and compressive sensing. And what it is you take your data, this is your input, sort of a low dimensional representation of the data. And if you take a face, it's a raster of pixels, you literally make a vector of those. Okay, I'm just going to work you through this very quickly. So a single face is a vector of pixels, right? Long, long vector. It's extremely sparse. Pixel space is a tiny, you know, it's huge as pixel space, but an image space is a much tinier dimension of pixel space. And then you place over this a matrix, which is a random sample. It's important that measurement matrix, a random matrix, not be coherent with respect to the information. So some random subsample of the system, and you repeat this problem, you train the system up to get a transform basis that gives you a set of very, very sparse sparse coefficient. It's sparse because you're using L1 norm minimization to get that sparse set of coefficients. And what they did is they said, you know, let me ask if I could do a sparse sensing in a face. And here are the sample points you would need to discriminate one face from another. Okay, sort of interesting. It's the corners of the mouth, around the nose, and the eyes is where the informative pixels are. The rest are not useful pixels. And what's also equally interesting is in the 1960s, Yarbus used eye tracking software to see when you look at somebody's face, what are the exact motions your eyes do? Stunningly close to the sparse sampling. That your brain already knows, don't scan here. You're not going to learn a lot, right? scan here. Most of the information's here, here, and here. Exactly where you discriminate different faces. And in fact, that's comforting. Okay, that's good news. This is sort of a fun problem. And here's where I want to sort of pull on this thread. Sparse and compressive sampling works beautifully for exactly this problem of discriminating categories of things. I could say, can I discriminate a cat from a dog? Can I discriminate one human face from another human face? And the state of the art is, in fact, developing optimization methods to make this work well and training methods to make this work well. Neural systems have a much, much harder issue here. That is, the signals, particularly in sensor arrays, are not snapshots, right? So when the animal's flying around, its wing isn't saying, here, at this moment in time, is all the information I need. What it is there's sort of a spatial temporal data set that neural systems have to deal with. Not just a spatial data set, spatial temporal data sets. And we don't actually have very good methodologies for doing dimension reduction in this regard. So Bing, along, as I said, those are snapshots. Neurons respond to complex spatial temporal signals. And one of the problems is you have to do dimension reduction not just in the space, the pixel space, so to speak, but in temporal space at any one pixel is varying in time, right? How can you do that? So in this wing project, so I'm going to back up. I have to give you some more information. This is going to be a micro tutorial on what gets a neuron to fire. Okay? So bear with me. What happens is, I have my wing. I'm flying along. Sorry, I just love flight. I'm flying along. It's uplifting, as they say. And the wing is experiencing torsional dynamics and aerodynamic forces and inertial forces, and it's bending and twisting as this animal flies along, okay? And at the base are rectangular arrays of maybe, about patches of about 50 to 100 strain sensors in arrays, okay? And any one of those strain sensors, here's that white noise, is a single one. This is one of them. I'm recording from it. And that's when a neuron fired, okay? Just so you see what's going on, okay? Those are the timestamps of a neuron firing. One single cell, okay? And I repeat this exact same signal. I just repeat it. And that neuron responds again. And I repeat it again and again and again. This is called a raster plot. And what it shows is this neuron is firing with respect to this white noise extremely, extremely faithfully. Okay? It's faithfully firing, in fact, with sub-millisecond precision, or 200 microsecond precision, maybe 100. That's incredibly precise and reliable and true firing. It's adherent to the signal beautifully. Okay? But what is it about the signal that gets the neuron to fire? What was it that got the neuron to decide to fire? It was a decision. It was a decision based on sensory information, and it had to weigh that decision, says it's time to fire or not. Right? A single cell is making a decision. Okay? It's not sitting there thinking about it, but it is, in a sense, that's what sitting there thinking is cells making decisions. So here again is that stimulus, and here are the spike train. I'm going to show you how we analyze this, and this is sort of a reduced order analysis. I'm going to build this back into sparse sensing. But at each time that neuron fires, I can ask, what was the stimulus just ahead of it that got it to fire? So it comes along here, And boom, it fired. And there's another one. And I'm capturing the stimulus preceding each fire. I'm saying this is the stimulus that got that one cell to fire. And I could do this for the thousands of times it responded to that rich stimulus. Okay, and I build what's called an ensemble of the stimuli that got that one cell to fire. What this is a very high-dimensional structure of a stimulus, right, whose average is one measure of it, right, that precedes a firing event. And here is the actual data set. The average is something I can do. So here, in fact, is a data set that's about a week old from Brandon in the lab. And here you see the stimulus, the mean stimulus prior to firing, and this is the standard deviation of that stimulus. And notice it pinches down into this really interesting structure. Was it the magnitude? Was it the time history? This is a high dimensional representation of a stimulus that gets a neuron to fire. So what this is doing is it's taking a time series data set and discretizing it into a singular event. So I actually am measuring strain and its temporal history. In a sense, what a neuron is doing in my array, like this is an image, right? I have this image of my strain at any time distributed over the surface, but each neuron may be giving a slightly different time compression of the data, okay? One more thing. I can ask, how similar does the stimulus have to be to this template, right, in order to get that neuron to fire? Does that be exactly like the template, or kind of, right? So computationally, what we do is we go through and we take the projection of that stimulus onto the projection of this feature onto the stimulus every time I see it occurring. So I go to every spike and I look down and say, how similar is that stimulus to that event, to my template, my kernel, right? And you know, many times when it's very much like that thing that gets my neuron to fire, right, I have a high count. And if it's very dissimilar, if the stimulus doesn't look at all like the feature extractor I've built, right, those would be rare events, and you'll have some sort of function. It's called the decision function. It says, if my stimulus is very far from my feature, if the projection of my feature onto the stimulus is very weak, I'm not going to fire that neuron. If, however, they're very similar, I'm very likely to fire, and it's a probability distribution, right? This is actually a very bad representation of what really happens. What really happens is an extremely sharp and extremely selective neurons. That is, I need to look a lot like that stimulus, that feature, rather, in order to fire. Otherwise, I'm not going to fire, right? And it turns out the feature set of all of the neurons in the wings are extremely diverse. Some are tuned to one feature, some are tuned to another. And unfortunately, which I won't go into, this is actually the simple version, meaning this is just the average stimulus. But in fact, all of the stimuli that got that one neuron to fire have a covariance structure. And so I can have eigenvectors of features in higher dimensions that get that neuron to fire. Okay, wonderful. Here's what Bing and Annika and Brad and others have done. So they took the wing, computed for a model wing what the strain dynamics were in the wing. They asked the following question is, let me ask, if I'm flying like this and my wing is flapping and all of a sudden I experience a perturbation, I want to know, can I use the strain information on the wing at the moment of the perturbation, right, to discriminate whether I was flying with or without the perturbation? It's sort of asking about gust rejection or body dynamic rejection. Really interesting bio-inspired idea, right? What they did is they gave it the short memory, this feature detector, and a decision function, some threshold nonlinearity, and ask, can I do basically pass the snapshots of strain through a neural filter and ask how well that does in comparison to standard sparse sensing? And here's what they got. These are on the tip of the wing is this way, the width of the wing is that way. These are where you want to place your sensors for optimum separation of knowing whether you're going forward or being gust rejected. So it's a discrimination task, right? And it turns out if you just use the strain at a point in time, like a snapshot, like a picture of a person, it's very difficult to know that you've been perturbed. If, however, you pass that strain information through this temporal filter, so you actually compress time data into a discrete event and make a spike system, you actually get very good separation. This is no rotation and rotation, right? And very much fewer sensors required to do that. And at the end of the day, this makes a lot of sense. A nervous system says, I'm measuring things now and in the past to make decisions. And I compress those into singular events called spikes. And I use that to make decisions about whether I've felt something. Okay, winding up. So what biological principles provide inspiration for improving efficiency? I think many analog hybrid channels are really interesting, building neuromorphic systems, such as what Professor Shi works on. Sending information over many small, low-cost, low-capacity channels, but many of them in parallel, is what we naturally do. We are very task-specific or bespoke in our computation. That is, we build our neural systems for the task set at hand, which is quite broad, right? And we employ sparse and compressive sensing strategies. This is what we've been most excited about. And the filtering and the kernels involved are processed out at the periphery. It's actually the primary afferents, the primary sensors that are doing much of the computation inherently. Retinal computation is done in the retina. We're doing peripheral computation through these kernels. But it's the hardware is sort of the software of this system. Programming is in 3D. As I said, the hardware is the software, and we compute with proteins. I'm going to end with this somewhat harebrained concept that Professor Shing has been involved with in Seattle as well. There is a colleague of mine, David Baker, who his area is protein design. And we were talking about efficient computing. I said, you know, the bottom line is that even proteins are doing compute. And he says, well, I could build a protein of any shape you can specify. And what he does is he literally designs the amino acid sequence to minimize the energy associated with a particular geometry, and then solves for the DNA sequence, and then actually makes them. So he does this reverse engineering of proteins that's, you know, world-renowned at this point, right? And he said, I can make a protein of any shape, but they don't do anything. You know, they just have shape. And I said, well, can you make the proteins undergo shape change in response to a ligand, like a chemical sensor? He says, well, they should. That's what they do. What I've shown here are some images of proteins that he's fabricated. He designed these triangular proteins that self-assemble into these giant arrays. And the question he's asking is, can one build a computer based on proteins? Might this be a future of computing, where, in fact, the fabrication costs, you can make a mole of proteins in E. coli or in yeast, right? He can design them. He can create the DNA sequence that's needed to make any shape. And they're wondering if they can assemble them in three dimensions and do actual three-dimensional computing in protein, calling it computase, okay? It turns out that this is a hard computational problem. That is, if you have a geometry with six faces, how do you do ands and ors and nans in clusters of these things? It's sort of a cellular automaton problem. And it's just been really interesting. And so we've been working on this a bit with a million gates in one cubic micrometer. That's not bad by transistor standards. This can be fabricated. How you control the inputs and outputs is a complete mystery. But this is something we're thinking about now. I think what I'm going to do is wrap up. I'm going to pass through all my gates and end with a couple of comments. Silicon is known for speed, accuracy, engineerability, precise behavior, regular structures. That's why we work with it, and it will not go away. Don't get me wrong. Biology has extreme sensitivity, extreme efficiency, high physical, that's an I there, physical density, replicability, and adaptability, and it's plastic, highly adaptive. Okay? These are key differences. This is very much a digital world. This is very much a sort of somewhere in between digital and analog. I think what we're interested in is how do we get the best of both? It would be really interesting to extract from biology things it does very, very well, but integrate it with existing technologies, such as integrating neural systems into devices that we have, right? In doing so, our goal is to discover principles that nature uses to do really difficult tasks and to inspire new engineering. Right away, we're already intrigued by using neural filters in sparse and compressive sensing. And it's an open problem, by the way, in neuroscience to understand how neural systems are processing information in arrays of sensors. And then it's a fun problem in, say, flight controls. How would you use an array of sensors in your wings as part of the flight control system? So it's this beautiful dialogue between the domains. That's what's got us excited. And at this point, I'm just going to end my talk.
I have two related questions, OK? When you talk about the sensors, how efficient they are, and different kind of a biological cell or system may go from around 100 to 300 the spikes. But that looks like it's correlated very well with the width of the actual sensor produced in Europe, which is around 1 millisecond. So therefore, the maximum you can get typically
kilohertz.
If you got 300, it's a very, very reasonable.
Yeah.
But that also, so the first question is there any correlation among those examples you talked about that the spike rate does respond maybe to the different width of the actual potential in this different biological organ? A second question is a kind of speculation. You know, this day we talk about aliens in different planets, and we are searching for the sky of, you know, whether there are other livable planet. And we speculate, you know, that some alien may come to the Earth and they could be smarter than us. Now, that means maybe the action plans are actually not in 1 millisecond, maybe 0.1 millisecond, it would be more than 10 times smarter. Now, so the question is that can we start doing some engineering, make humans smarter, by changing the width of the action potential of our neuron. So maybe in 1,000 generation, we would be as smart as the alien. So that's a speculation.
So this is a really, really good question, and there is a really good answer to it. As I said, we don't compute anywhere near as fast or precisely as silicon does. Okay. And it turns out that the width of the action potential is subject to natural selection on the basis of the kind of channel proteins that you have. And it also turns out that the tighter the width, the more expensive it is, because you have to pull the current back down quite quickly. Okay. So there's a trade-off between precision speed on one side and cost on the other. And there's a paper, it's not out yet, it's in review. It's not mine. I'm giving a lot away. It's really good. I hope the other reviewer agrees. That shows that if you look at the surface of energy efficiency, there's efficiency and speed. It's a very interesting surface, and biology is operating right at the rim, where it's doing about as good as it can do for the energy it's got. Yes, you can make theoretically faster action potentials, but it's going to get hotter and more expensive to do so, and that's why we make silicon. Now, if an alien comes down, it's smarter than us, and maybe because it has more channels. It doesn't need to have faster ones, right? And we could certainly, I don't want to talk about U.S. politics right now. Did I answer your question? It's a really interesting study, but Jeremy Niven is one of the authors. So.
Yeah, I want to ask a question about the equations. At the very beginning, you showed between the input and the output, right? Measure spikes versus use the electrode, whatever.
Yeah. Right.
So, did you consider the non-neuron cells? You know, from my evolution point of view, even plant has this capability of absorbing any kind of sensing and signals, right? So this non-neural cells could absorb some of the energy put in. You actually underestimate the bits per spike.
Just for the cells that have nothing to do with the computing. That's certainly true. Where we were getting the cost of action potentials was from direct measurements of the energy, so it does include some of this sort of non-firing energy as well.
Your equation, when you start this equation, that's very accurate. You need to consider those.
That's absolutely right.
A or B constant.
In terms of the estimate of the coherence to get the information. There's another dirty secret that I didn't go into. You reminded me. So the information contained between the stimulus and the response is measured by the coherence, and it's called the SR, stimulus response coherence, right? If you look, so your first guess would be, what would happen if I looked at the coherence between two successive responses? So I can say how coherent is the stimulus with respect to the response, but how coherent are any two pairs of responses, these two rows? And it turns out the coherence between responses is larger than the coherence between the stimulus and response. And it shows that there's some nonlinear information processing going on at lower frequencies that we just have no sense of. That is, something about getting the system excited gives it a regular behavior that you're not picking from just the stimulus to response. So, as I said, there's much more information actually being passed than we're accounting for simply on the basis of stimulus response.
I don't know if that helped.
I always think you need some kind of constant put in the equation to take
care just to take care of the base rate.
Yes, because for example, very simple evidence. If you touch the mimosa, plant, you have to touch twice to get a response. So that means between the first and the second, at the using the coherence may be changed. Systems, yeah.
So that's a slightly different problem.
They will be changing.
Yeah. It's a slightly different problem. The other one is the Venus flytrap,
yeah.
Where you have to actually touch
twice,
yeah. Two different hairs. But it has to be timed right. In other words, if you touch one and wait too long and you touch another, nothing happens. And what the idea is, there's a memory in the system that we're not exactly accounting for. But the memory is that when you hit this first one, there's a slow depolarization wave that moves to the next hair. And then if you hit it fast enough, when that wave is present, then it further depolarizes and it gets the plant to trigger. But there's a cost associated with that, and there's a memory in that system too.
Yes. So thanks for the great talk. So I wanted to ask, the issue with the biological systems is it's not fast enough, right? And the experiments that you've done for the flight control, while measuring the bit rate, you're inputting white noise, right? So I want to ask, what if the input was something else, like for a reflex action, the computation would be considerably faster. Have there been any experiments regarding reflex actions and what their bit rate is and how fast they are? And I have another question.
So reflexes are slower relative to what we were measuring. Because reflexes, what we're measuring is from the end of the neuron to somewhere else in that neuron. So there's no connections, right? Reflexive arcs have an end of a neuron all the way from that neuron to another one. And they usually have at least one, if not more, synaptic connections between neurons, okay? So reflexes are fast, but we're measuring pre-reflex. We're measuring the information before it ever gets there.
Okay, so per length, if you consider per length, then would it change?
I know what you're asking.
That's a really good question. So there's a cost associated with transmission. I mean, this is part of what you're saying. If your action potential has to travel a very, very long distance, you have to support a very large cell with a very large total depolarization. The shorter the distance is, the less total cost. But now the cost per unit distance is slightly dependent on the diameter. And it's sort of a cable property. Any computational neuroscientists in the audience? You need one here. The cable properties are such that the cost scales with axon diameter. And larger diameter axons propagate signals more rapidly, but at greater cost. So I don't know. I don't know the answer.
I have to write that down. This is a good question. I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
I was saying that Sigafu actually
gave
measured.
By the way, you said we're not fast, and I keep coming up to this statement that is, we are not fast if you're comparing an operation in silicon with us, but we're gigantically and massively parallel, okay? Really parallel. Lots of, as I said, low capacity, cheap channels, such that the compute you're doing right now and the computations that your brain is currently doing, right, way exceed anything we can do on the planet in silicon. And you're not burning up, right? I mean, you're just using reasonable amounts of energy, right? If you were to try and reproduce this computation in the volume of your brain in silicon, it would just completely burn up. So while you think we're not fast, we are extremely fast because of the complex computation we're doing. So, yeah.
You talk about the high sensitivity of some cells, but we know that if some cells are very sensitive, then a lot of signals are noise. And so there should be a good noise filtering mechanism. So, like us, are there anything special? And secondly, where there is a trade off in sensitivity.
Yeah, so. That's a really good question. So with high sensitivity comes noise sensitivity, generally. One of the advantages of these matched filters, that this basically these high-dimensional signal shapes, these matched filters give a bit of noise rejection. So that is, in random noise, the probability, you're reducing the probability that your stimulus is random if your match filter is fairly high dimensional, right? So the spike-triggered average, that particular shape, can occur randomly. But now if you take the higher dimensional versions of it, you get fewer and fewer likelihoods that those are going to happen. So it's not completely noise rejection, but some match filter helps on that.
Which means you need to have an array of sensors.
Array of sensors, and also the cell itself, the mechanics provides some match filters. So the reason why our cell, why that neuron has that particular geometry of a spike triggered average, that particular kernel, that feature it detects, has to do with how the protein is actually mechanically coupled. So it's a mechanical information processing through the membrane and protein responses to stretching of the neuron. So that gives also, through whatever mechanisms, these are some protein scaffolds that support it, give, again, some sort of dynamic filtering to the signal. And then the array is even better. So if I take an array and I just look for the common mode, I get rid of a lot. And that's and there are other neat things that do delay correlators and other things like that that can also help reduce noise. The last thing is, you know, we are doing, this is not something I can prove, okay, but I'm just going to say it. When we're doing computations with our neural systems, we're not doing image reconstruction. We are categorizing things. We're putting things into bins, and that requires a coarser resolution, right? So doing decision making is fundamentally a different compute than doing reconstruction. So an open problem that we are working on now is how, when we build controls for robotics, control systems for robotics, we basically are taking an input signal, doing a continuous analog conversion of it, and using it in direct feedback. It's not so common to say, well, you know, I'm kind of doing okay for now, so I'm not going to do much. And then when I'm perturbed, I'll do some. But do these categorical things, I've been perturbed, I'm not perturbed, as opposed to really, really, really detailed reconstruction of information. And what we're doing is approximate computing. We're doing just good enough compute. And in fact, there's a whole range of computing coming out right now called approximate computing, right? Which is exactly this problem, is do enough compute to get the job done, but not much more. And that is also helps noise reject, because it bins things. That's a super great point.
Tommy, you do a reverse. Now, you do image recognition, right? Now, if I want to recall the image, remember, I see you, I can see the feature, but now I don't see you, I can remember your feature. How does the reverse process work? Because you do need to reconnect them to reconstruct.
You don't reconstruct. You build comparators. So you have sort of a Bayesian computation that your brain. This is so we're going way off now on how do I match? So say I see this student here, and now I'm gone. The student's gone, and I might see you again on the street. How will I recognize you? And what it is a subset, a very small subset of features that I do a comparator on my memory template. So I don't exactly store and compress the students, sorry, or this student, or any of it. I'm not picking on this one person. I don't, or you, right? How do I recognize you? Is there features of way? And I said where there's a will, there's a way. But when there are features of way that I recognize, right? It's his glasses, his hair, his smile. His gentle demeanor. But there are features, and you can have, and what you do, this is very likely that same person. I don't say this is exactly that same person, right? So I do these best guess. But you have a template.
Yes, you have to have that reference to compare.
That's right. And that reference is probably that really small subset of samples that are stored. You don't reconstruct, you just store enough. All of you would, if I left the room and I spoke again outside of the room, you recognize my voice. You're not doing the full spectrum. You're doing features of the spectrum that you're recognizing. Right? You're not doing a spectral recomposition of my voice.
But if I see a pair of twins.
He's pushing it. Keep going. Yeah, okay.
So the wife, the twins, certainly, presumably you can recognize the difference.
I have a hard time with some twins, right?
I'm not talking about you.
It's because I'm cheap. There are, yes, there is refinement. Yeah, so for example, the other thing you can do, well, the other side of this is you can recognize relatives of individuals who you don't know. You can say, oh, you two are clearly related, right? I can see features in common, right? But it turns out it's a very, very small subset of the feature space that you do. You can recognize, I have a whole neuroscience set of lectures, I'm not going to do it, but you can recognize there's a set of psychophysical experiments that you can recognize different individuals by their gait, by the pattern of how their body moves. You can actually take a 7-dot human and animate the dots, and you can tell gender. You can tell mood from just about 7 dots out of a person. Seven. Yeah. 7 discrete moving points. Maybe I'll demonstrate that, but not right now. Okay. But yes, we're really good at categorical comparisons. And as you said, if they're coarse, we do coarse really well, and you get finer and finer, and there are additional features you do. The more important the task is, the more you're trained to do it, the more features you add to it. But I need relatively few features to discriminate, you know, a human from a dog, and even fewer from a planaria, right? Again, I'm not going to leave U.S. politics out of this, it is the more critical the task or the more important it is that you do the discrimination, the more features you require. And that's why it's very task-specific computing. Okay. Thank you. It's a very engaged group. Thank you very much.